Hey guys, Mike here. Quick paper I want to share with you. So this is going to be a very informal video, but it's hot off the press from the Endocrine Society. The paper is titled Executive Summary to EDC2. So this is the Endocrine Society's second scientific statement on endocrine disrupting chemicals. And let me just get to the chase and jump right to the end of this. Now, if you want to read this paper, download it, share it with a physician, share it with your pediatrician or someone in the chemical industry, please do. The link below to this full text, it's an open source PDF. You can download that to you. So let me read to you what gave me the chills, actually. Okay, this is one of the final paragraphs here. It says, a further need for precaution is based on evidence that individuals exposed to endocrine disrupting chemicals may carry that body burden for their entire lives in the case of long-lived chemicals, such as the polybrominated flame retardants and diethyl ethers and so forth. Now, that even short-lived chemicals may induce changes that are permanent, and that some actions of endocrine disrupting chemicals are observed in individuals' offspring. Okay, so meaning that dads and moms, if you're exposed to these compounds and have kids, those compounds affect the offspring's endocrine system, female reproductive system, hormone reproductive system, and more. Now, here's a really powerful final sentence here. It says, transgenerational, meaning these effects carry on throughout generations. Okay, transgenerational effects of endocrine disrupting chemicals mean that even if a chemical is removed from use, so even if we introduce one of these chemicals into the environment and later found out that, oh my goodness, it has these profound effects, even if we remove that, its imprints on the exposed individual's DNA may persist for generations and possibly forever. And so that's what's really scary about these endocrine disrupting chemicals is they're rarely tested in humans. They're mostly tested in animal models in isolation, not in the synergistic effects that we're all exposed to, you know, in air, food, water, and our clothing, our pillows and couches and bedding and so forth. We all have a lot of these levels. Even polar bears in Antarctica have high levels of these in their blood. So certainly you, if you're listening to this or watching this in an industrialized place in the world, definitely have high levels of this in your bloodstream. Now, what's really powerful is these compounds have been shown to affect our epigenome, and that's the molecular structure of our DNA, and change gene expression that affect obesity, diabetes, female and hormone reproductive issues, neurodevelopmental issues, thyroid issues, prostate issues, breast health, much more. So very powerful stuff. Again, this paper was just published today by the Endocrine Society. It's a follow-up to their EDC1, which was published in 2009. And if you're interested in diving into this in more detail, I posted the link below this video in a blog post that I did back in 2012. So it's a little bit old, but it went through the different pharmacokinetic effects and the differences between an endocrine disrupting chemical that affects our hormonal axis and how that is different from, say, testosterone and estrogen and thyroid hormone. Because all of our own endogenous hormones adhere to linear pharmacokinetics, and they are often bound to binding globulins, whereas like sex hormone binding globulin, thyroid hormone binding globulin, and so forth. That's why, you know, the body can help to regulate hormonal levels in a system. In contrast, these endocrine disrupting chemicals don't bind to those binding globulins. They exist in the free state. So they can actually antagonize your own hormones at the receptor level. They can change receptor function and cause the, you know, cellular cascade as though the message is there. And they can do a lot of nasty things. So big aha moment here, breakthrough from the Endocrine Society. Please share this information. Send a copy to a physician that you know or a pediatrician, someone to influence them to read this and take action on this. So again, thanks for tuning in. Click the link below if you want to get the PDF. Talk to you soon.
Joining us in the charge to accelerate the evolution of medicine. Now, here's your host, James Maskell.
What's up? Hey, everyone. Good welcome. I can tell the rowdiness factor is still around from the wine from last time. It's really good to have you guys all here. We have you know, such an awesome lineup of speakers tonight. I'm very excited to have you all here and everyone watching at home. We've got a record number of meetup groups meeting up this evening, gathering communities of practitioners together. So we're very excited to have in the room some awesome speakers. Dr. Pedre's back for another keynote. We're excited to have him. Elisa Vitti, first time on the forum. She came to the very first forum in between now and then, had a baby. So welcome back. That's part of the credibility piece. Yahoo Health's in the house. What's up, Liz? How you doing? Dr. Cotter as well. I'm very, very excited about tonight's show, the Hormone Symphony, and I think the word symphony perfectly describes exactly what we're going to talk about. This is a complicated matter, but it's not out of the realms of possibility that all of us can do great hormonal medicine, and that's why we bring it all to you for free now. So as in previous cases, you can ask questions. We're going to have a panel later with all the speakers. So if you use hashtag functional forum on Twitter, you can ask questions and we'll address those to the panel later. And feel free to share the link to this with professionals, especially people who are interested in hormone health. As I said before, this is our IFM collaboration. Now, we did two in the summer with IFM that were pre-recorded. This is the first one that is live. And we really appreciate Laurie Hoffman's in the house. Welcome, Laurie. So glad to have you here at the forum. And the power of the IFM has been to bring us really amazing content as part of our show. We want to keep bringing the best functional medicine content, and we really appreciate the role they've played in getting us this far. And I know they have a big vision for where they're taking this. But also, thanks so much to the IFM for endorsing the meetup groups, because we have 63 new meetup groups compared to last month with this month, including South Africa and Australia and Slovenia, and even out in Asia as well. So it's happening. So lots of exciting things happening in the IFM right now, and I'm just going to mention a couple of them. I've had Dr. Rangan Chatterjee on the show a couple times, and I wasn't really allowed to say up until now about his show, but I think this show just got confirmed over the weekend as when it's starting. It's Thursday, November the 19th from 9 to 10 p.m. on BBC One in the UK. That's 4 o'clock Eastern. Now, we've had him on the show a couple times. He is going to be an amazing representation of functional medicine. And in his show, he essentially shows it's sort of like Dr. Oz meets Super Nanny. That's the format. And so imagine what would happen if a 6'7" doctor came and like stayed in your house for a month. Well, I will tell you that in the episodes, he reverses someone's type 2 diabetes in 4 weeks, gets a guy off opioids. It's going to be the first time that we're going to see in a short period of time that the reversal of chronic disease is not only possible, but actually in some cases not that difficult if you can really get to the behavior changes in very quickly. So I've been toying with teaching people how to get online and watch this illegally. Now, I'm not going to tell you exactly how to do it. I'm not going to advise that you do that. But if you did want to do it, there's an app called Hola, which means it's H-O-L-A, and you can block your IP address, and then you can go to the BBC iPlayer and watch it. So I didn't tell you that. But if you are available at 4 p.m. Eastern on the 19th, I guarantee it's going to be worth your while to check it out. So that's some exciting news that's happening with the IFM, and I think this is going to make a big impact starting in America. I'd imagine it'll be on BBC America soon. I'd imagine it'll be on mainstream TV soon, although you can't be too sure because we all know what happens on the ads between the show, and so you can never be too sure. But it's not the only exciting thing happening with the IFM. There's also this.
Cleveland Clinic is building a clinical center of excellence in functional medicine, the first one in the world, including a model for apprenticeship and mentorship. Hi, I'm Dr. Mark Hyman. Welcome. I'm here with my friend and colleague, Dr. Patrick Canaway, who's the medical director of the Cleveland Clinic Center for Functional Medicine, and I'm the director. I'm also the chairman of the board of the Institute for Functional Medicine.
Thanks, Mark. As some of you know, I'm the Chief Medical Education Officer at IFM, and I've chosen to move my clinical practice here to Cleveland to be part of this incredible opportunity for learning, service, and research.
We launched here on October 2nd, 2014, with the full support of the leadership of the Cleveland Clinic. The center, in fact, was initiated by the CEO, Toby Cosgrove, not by us. He asked us to come here to do this here because he sees this as the future of healthcare. And the demand has been so tremendous that we've exceeded our capacity to take care of the patients who want to come here and work with us. Cleveland Clinic is founded on a tradition of creativity and innovation.
We're performing research on functional medicine, randomized trials in the areas of asthma, migraines, inflammatory bowel disease, and type 2 diabetes. We're doing outcomes research on value-based care and the total cost of care. What we offer will cost less money for the system overall, and the patients feel better. We're also collaborating with many of the key institutes right here at the Cleveland Clinic.
That's what's been so amazing to me, Patrick. We're not fighting an uphill battle here. The directors of all the institutes, the chairs, are coming to us to collaborate. We met with the heads of the Heart Vascular Institute, Urology, and Pediatrics, who are interested in bringing functional medicine into their institutes. They recognize their need to change the way we practice medicine. We're doing extraordinary things in education. We're bringing functional medicine and nutrition into the medical school curriculum and also building graduate and CME programs that can scale around the world. We also have to decentralize healthcare and bring it to where people live. And using population health and community-based programs, we're really transforming health throughout the community and building a model for the nation. This is an extraordinary place, unlike anything I've ever seen in healthcare. It's unique among all major healthcare institutions. So we invite you to be part of this groundbreaking initiative. Come with us, work with us here to transform healthcare at one of the world's leading healthcare institutions.
Let's have a round of applause for the Cleveland Clinic. It's super exciting. In our fourth ever functional forum back in May 2014, Mark came and spoke and told us about the, was sort of like the first to break the Cleveland Clinic news. And I'm super excited just to see the outcomes research more than anything else, because in a couple of years' time, all healthcare is going to be paid on outcomes. And at exactly that moment, I would say that we're going to have, you know, real proof from a central, credible academic institution that functional medicine is a more appropriate intervention, lower cost intervention for a lot of these chronic diseases. So it's an exciting time to be in this field, and again, thanks IFM for leading the way. Last week, we did a bit of an experiment called the Evolution of Medicine Film Festival, and it was pretty awesome. We engaged our practitioner network to be able to do a screening of Escape Fire through a company called Tug, and it was a great success. We had a couple of dozen across the country. I actually ended up going to one in California last Tuesday. So Dr. Hilda Maldonado and Jason put it on, and it was a great success. You know, sitting in a room full of people who probably didn't know anything, and Escape Fire is really the best film at educating the population about integrative medicine and the potential for it to have an impact on chronic disease. So we thought we were just going to do it once, but it turns out everyone else is continuing to do it. So if you go to goevomed.com/film, you can see all the screenings coming up. We're just going to keep it rolling. And we're also going to interview a couple of practitioners that did it and have gained, you know, in some cases, dozens and dozens of new patients at no cost to them, and also have engaged their community really well. So lots of potential to do that. So watch out for that. So here we are with the Hormone Symphony. We have a lot of great content tonight. For the first time, we're actually going to provide an IFM Presents segment, which means that this is actually delivered by the IFM inside of our show. And so we're actually going to present Dr. Vince Pedre. He's got a book coming out next year called Happy Gut, and a great practitioner when it comes to hormones. Again, if you have questions for Dr. Pedre, you can ask on Twitter with Functional Forum. We have a glut of awesome Cuban doctors here at the Functional Forum that come up. Gio's in the house, Dr. Castellanos. We've got a little Cuban revolution. And so I will lead it to Dr. Vince Pedre. Welcome.
A little bit of salsa. We have to bring a little flavor to the Functional Forum and IFM, right? So I'm talking about this triad tonight, which I am very passionate about, the gut, adrenals, and thyroid. This is probably, I would say 90% of my practice is focused on this. And one thing I've learned over the years as I've been training and becoming certified in functional medicine is that pretty much every adrenal and thyroid patient has a gut issue going on. So when you're treating these patients, you have to approach it from this very comprehensive point of view. So I'm going to start with some news. I have bad news and I have good news. Which one would you want first? Why does everyone say bad first? Well, you guessed it. Well, I don't know what happened with the... you can't see the picture in the background, but that's part of the bad news back there. So that's basically a trash pile that's full of plastics and other toxins that we dump. And in the background, you can see that the sky is kind of shady, smoggy. So it's probably full of ground level ozone and polyaromatic hydrocarbons from exhaust fuel. So we live in a toxic world that's toxic to our guts, to our adrenals, and our thyroid. So we already start challenged. And sometimes that toxicity looks quite good. It comes in the form of tasty, tempting, delicious pastries. And anybody who does functional medicine knows the connection between gluten and a lot of thyroid issues, autoimmune disease, celiac disease. So the good news is that functional medicine has provided a rubric by which to approach these complex issues so that we can fix them and put the patient back into balance. So I'm starting with the Endocrine Society's second scientific statement on endocrine disrupting chemicals. And I think everybody was talking while Mike Mutzel was speaking at the beginning. But I wanted to highlight several effects that relate to the thyroid. We're talking about thyroid tonight. A number of chemicals, including but not limited to PCBs, PBDEs, which are polybrominated diphenyl ethers, can you say that fast three times? Those are fire retardants. Some phthalates and perchlorate can reduce circulating levels of thyroid hormone. But interestingly, these chemicals will not cause an increase in serum TSH. Wait a second. Isn't the TSH what we follow to diagnose hypothyroidism? So what this is saying is that the very test that is used as the gold standard to decide if a patient has a functioning thyroid or not is maybe obsolete because of these environmental chemicals. Then these thyroid disruptors also increase the risk of prenatally exposed children to cognitive deficits and a lower IQ. So this is very disturbing. So I'm going to move on. So we start with the gut. I like calling the gut the seat of our health. The surface area is 200 times that of the skin. It's our biggest inside-outside surface. The small intestine itself is 20 feet long with a surface area of a tennis court. Just imagine how big that is, that surface of interaction. And the large intestine is 5 feet long. So I use this diagram of the tree I thought was beautiful. The body of the tree is represented by the leaves and the trunk, and or our bodies, and the gut is represented by the roots. And it's in direct contact with the soil and the environment, and it serves as the gatekeeper. It's where all the nutrients, microbes, toxins, these endocrine-disrupting chemicals, food additives, drugs, all of this is coming through the gut. And then along with the gut, we have our co-pilot. I call it our co-pilot, the microbiome. It weighs up to 4.4 pounds. And the gut flora outnumbers our cells 10 to 1. And if you count how many bacteria and archaea are in our gut, the estimate is up to 100 trillion. So I put this picture here of the Milky Way. You see the estimate is somewhere between 100 and 400 billion. So we have more bacteria in our guts than there are stars in the Milky Way. So I call it our own personal galaxy, right inside here. And the microbiota's genetic material is 150 times that of the human cell. And there's four basic phyla, 1,100 prevalent species, and these species can vary across the world and depending on endemic diet and where people are from, and approximately 160 of these species per individual. And we know that it interacts with our hormone system because there is an obese microbiota that creates, extracts more energy and can cause metabolic syndrome, so it disrupts insulin signaling. So if the gut were an actor and was invited to attend the Academy Awards, I would say it would be nominated for Best Supporting Actor. So in the hormone system, one example of this is the glucuronide pathway. And going back to those endocrine disrupting chemicals and the hormones, this pathway helps control the excess of these metabolites in our bodies, but also the excess of our own hormones. So the first step in the liver is cancer-causing chemicals, steroid hormones, other toxins are bonded to this glucuronic acid. It's basically an anchor that's used to get it out of our body. Then step two, the metabolites are dumped in the bile into the intestines. Now, if you have certain bacteria that have this enzyme called beta-glucuronidase, so like E. coli, Clostridium perfringens, or Bacteroides, then they can actually cleave the glucuronide bond and release the hormone or toxin, and it gets recirculated back into the body. So now we think of all the estrogen dominance that we have with these xenoestrogens and then your own estrogen, and think about how partly how it can be created. And these are some of the foods that can help short-circuit this enzyme. So again, it's the idea in functional medicine is eating the rainbow of vegetables. So I found this picture, and I thought this is a perfect representation of our gut lining. So if you imagine the stone wall is the gut lining itself with all the cells. This looks like a very healthy gut with the cells all abutting each other. There's no empty space between the cells. And then the microbiome are these little plants. They're all along the gut lining. You can think of the shrubs there as the food particles that are about to get digested. And these trees here are the antigen-presenting cells. They're waiting on the other side, just monitoring and watching for whatever it is that comes through, whether it's bacteria, toxin. And back there, you see there's a little bit of those yellow bushes kind of sneaking in past the gut lining. And that's a leaky gut. So let's look at this another way. So healthy gut versus a leaky gut. So in this diagram, you can see that the healthy gut has very well-formed tight junctions, and only nutrients are getting through. Bacteria and food particles are staying in the gut lumen. Then you go to a leaky gut, and what's happened is there is a compromised junction, and even also the villi themselves have been compromised. So things like bacteria, bacterial toxins, food particles, so you develop food sensitivities. So you have to go back and think, how does this affect the patient with an adrenal issue, a thyroid issue? If they're already inflamed and now their gut is inflamed, it's creating system-wide inflammation. And this is just a little animation, compliments of IFM. I was very appreciative. But I don't know, what happened to the animations? We lost it. Just imagine that there's these little bouncy balls that come over here, and only the little ones get through. And then we go to the leaky gut, and you have these bigger balls that represent partially digested food molecules, and they're getting through these big spaces here. So you see how with the leaky gut, food sensitivities can come to be because your body is getting exposed to foods and proteins that it should not. And if you remember the picture of the garden, those trees there, the antigen-presenting cells, are waiting on the other side to see what comes through. So reasons for developing a leaky gut. Things like NSAIDs, a dysbiosis, an acute gastroenteritis, stress, which also alters our gut flora, advanced glycation end products. We know that gluten and also the way that they mature wheat by spraying it with glyphosate, which has been shown to poke holes in the lining of the intestines. So that in itself, just think of how ubiquitous are wheat products in our society that have been treated this way. And then chemicals, pesticides, artificial ingredients in our food. So leaky gut syndrome or gut dyspermeability, you can see that it has an effect on nutrient absorption. So macromolecules, partially digested proteins, will get through the gut epithelium and trigger an immune response. Nutrients, because the villi are damaged, cannot be absorbed efficiently. And you get things like zinc, iron, and B12 deficiency. And these are cofactors that we need for hormone production. So I'll talk about this a little bit later, how we need zinc, we need iron, for the production of thyroid hormone, for example. So if your ability to absorb these minerals is compromised, then you're not going to be able to create the hormones that your body needs. And then there's an effect from leaky gut on disease evolution. It's overactivation of the Th1 immune pathway. You get chronic inflammation. It's like you have a constant fire in your gut. And even something like a bacterial lipopolysaccharide, which is the most potent stimulator of the immune system, gets through. And again, continues to fuel this fire that affects the other systems in the body. So from here, I'm going to jump to the adrenal gland. So it's two really small glands that sit on top of the kidneys. And in this great drawing, you can see how they're subdivided into two main parts, the medulla and the cortex. The medulla is the one that produces the epinephrine and the norepinephrine, the fight or flight response. And then you have the cortex, which is divided into three different zones, the glomerulosa, the fasciculata, and the reticularis. And each of them, the biggest one, the fasciculata, is the one that produces cortisol. That's the one that we think of that is affected, but also the androgens, the DHEA and androstenedione. These hormones are affected in a patient that has adrenal insufficiency or the production thereof. So to better explain this, this is our stress response system. And it starts with the brain. So the hypothalamus produces on this side corticotropin releasing hormone, and on that side, thyroid releasing hormone, both of them stimulating the pituitary. On this side, the CRH is stimulating the release of ACTH, which then stimulates the adrenals to produce cortisol. Now, if this system is overactivated, say in a fight or flight or this chronic stress condition that we see people in our society living in, then you get overproduction of cortisol, a dysfunction in this axis, and then you see that it affects thyroid hormone production. So again, on that side, the TRH stimulates the pituitary to release TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone, and then you get the production of T4, which is the main hormone produced by the thyroid, 95% of it, and T3, which is actually the most active form of thyroid hormone, but that's only a small amount of the production. So we rely on the body to convert the T4 to T3 in the periphery, and part of this happens in the liver, and a lot of it happens in the cells. But if you have a high cortisol, and there are other things that can affect this system that we'll talk about, the high cortisol blocks this 5' deiodinase enzyme that converts the T4 to T3. So then instead, you get this other accessory pathway, which is to reverse T3. So the iodine is removed from a different position, and this is actually a more inert type of thyroid hormone. So it's basically, if you're in overdrive with your adrenals, the thyroid is going to try to put a brake on it. But the person that comes to see you in this condition feels horrible. They're exhausted, they're fatigued. It's hard for them to get out of bed in the morning. So to look at this in a different way, we see the normal person has hormone balance. As we move into stage one of adrenal dysfunction, you go into the alarm stage. So there's overproduction of cortisol. The DHEA drops, although it might not drop as far as it's showing here. It might be a little bit higher at this stage. And the person is in this constant fight or flight. So these are my patients that are pushing themselves really hard. They're staying at work late. They're not getting enough sleep. They're waking up early, drinking a lot of coffee to make it through the day. And if you continue in this stage, you move into stage two, which is adaptation. And what I tell my patients is that you can't expect your adrenals to run a marathon forever. They're going to wear down. And in many cases, people are trying to run super marathons, like 50, 100 milers. They're just going and going. So Here in stage two, the person is drinking several cups of coffee to power their system to make it through the day. And if you don't make changes in your lifestyle at that point, then you're going to progress to stage three. And this is the insufficiency stage. And this is where I see a lot of people in New York, but I'm sure across the country. They've pushed themselves so hard that they are exhausted and nothing makes them better. And even caffeine stops having an effect on it. And if you continue down to stage four is failure, and you see there's varying shades of this insufficiency, but in Western medicine, the only thing that we identify is Addison's disease, which is complete failure of the adrenal glands. So this is just another way to look at this. This would be the normal cortisol pattern. So we usually expect the peak in the early morning hours. And as the day goes on, the cortisol slowly drops. And by evening, it goes low so you can go to sleep. In a person with early stages of adrenal dysfunction, they lose that morning peak in the cortisol. So it starts becoming difficult to get out of bed. And maybe they have a discordant peak later in the day. So they actually feel better afternoon than they did in the morning. And maybe once they get into the evening, it's really hard to fall asleep. And the typical scenario is the person that feels tired but wired. So they can't shut off the mind. The final stages, you can see here, is more of a flat curve. So you barely get anything in the morning, and then it continues that way throughout the day. This is the person that can't get out of bed and is struggling to make it through their work day. And what are the things that might make this worse? So we look back at the endocrine disrupting chemicals, the xenoestrogens, food allergens, infections, free radicals, blood sugar. How many people are sugar addicted? Anyone? Just think about the roller coaster that creates in the body and the stress to the adrenals when the blood sugar drops and the adrenals have to kick in and recover the body from that blood sugar drop with cortisol, and then you start feeling the low again and you want another hit of sugar. And of course, chronic pain. That's also a major wear on the adrenals. So what we need balance. And this is what I constantly talk to my patients about. Yoga, meditation, Tai Chi. And I put the picture with, I love this picture because she's on wood and in the background there's green grass. So I think of earthing, of connecting with nature. Like, we need more of that. That's what replenishes us. I'm constantly working with my patients on creating this life-work balance. Like, which one wins out? What's worth it? So I'm going to jump from here to the thyroid. So thyroid gland sits about two-thirds of the way down from the jaw, right here under the Adam's apple for the men. And there's the two main types, the T4 and the T3. You can see that the iodine molecules are about the same, except that in T3, an iodine has been removed from one of the locations on the ring. And I wanted to make the connection between the gut back with autoimmune thyroid disease. So I found this study where the 169 patients with autoimmune thyroid disease, they looked at what other types of antibodies they may have that relate to the gut. And a pretty high number, 15% of them have anti-TTG, which is tissue transglutaminase antibodies. 15% about have IgA anti-gliadin antibodies. But look at this. 51% of these patients with autoimmune thyroid disease had IgG anti-gliadin antibodies. And I'm going to show a diagram in a little bit that's going to explain this better so we understand the connection between even like tissue transglutaminase and the thyroid. And what they also found was that if they looked at how much thyroid replacement hormone the patient was taking, the levels were much higher for patients that had higher levels of IgA antibodies. So suggesting that something is happening in the gut that's not allowing for good absorption of the thyroid hormone. So here's a picture of what happens in these patients when they eat gluten. So gluten comes in, and here, imagine that this is already slightly compromised gut lining. It's getting through in between the cells, so you have incompletely digested protein getting through. And it encounters tissue transglutaminase 2, an enzyme that's on the other side. It's in the extracellular space. It's found inside the cells. And it digests the gluten, creates a deaminated gliadin peptide. And then imagine that you're with a patient that tested positive for DQ2, HLA DQ2, or DQ8. So now they have the ability to identify this gliadin peptide as an antigen, as not self. And it stimulates the dendritic cells to then stimulate the CD4 T cells to create an immune response. And you get the Th1 response, which is the interferons, the TNF-alpha, and the IL-15, and then a Th2 response, which is the humoral response with antibodies to gluten and tissue transglutaminase. And I wanted to show this again in this diagram because I thought it was great, because I always wonder why tissue transglutaminase. So why is our body attacking self? And you see here that it can actually form a complex with gluten that then becomes antigenic, and it's stimulating, again, the people who are predisposed to this, the HLA-DQ2s, for example. And you get the tissue transglutaminase antibodies and the anti-gliadin antibodies. And up there, the matrix metalloproteinases are breaking up the lining, causing cell death. So it's fueling the fire and continuing to cause the leaky gut. So this study looked at people with celiac disease and autoimmune thyroiditis. And I thought this was interesting when I started looking into where is tissue transglutaminase. This enzyme is everywhere. It's found in cells, it's found in the nuclei, it's found in the extracellular matrix. It's found in thyroid follicular cells, and it's also found in the interfollicular area. So what they did is they looked at sera from tissue transglutaminase, IgA positive serum, of celiac disease patients and found that it bound thyroid follicular cells both extracellularly as well as intracellularly. And the pattern was not seen in sera that was taken from celiac patients that were on a gluten-free diet and did not have these antibodies, and neither from the control population. So you see the connection here between the gut and the thyroid, and possibly the avenue by which the thyroid breakdown starts. So if tissue transglutaminase is also present in the thyroid, then an attack on the tissue transglutaminase perhaps creates leaky thyroid syndrome. And I'm going to show a picture of how thyroid hormone is created a little bit later on, so you can see why there are certain proteins that are common in autoimmune thyroiditis that should not be exposed to our immune system. So what are the triggers? Inflammation, oxidative damage. So we see in celiac disease, I'm going to talk about the peroxidase system. So there's oxidative damage, and possibly iodine excess may fuel the fire. And then you see the production of antithyroglobulin and antithyroperoxidase antibodies. So these are two new players in the creation and the fueling of autoimmune thyroid disease. And then we conjecture that there are infections that could affect the thyroid. Epstein-Barr virus, other infections that compromise the gut lining, candida, mycoplasma, H. pylori, which has been associated with Graves, and Yersinia enterocolitica. In one study, they found that family members of patients with autoimmune thyroid disease were seropositive for virulence proteins for Yersinia. So we're thinking, you know, it's not a clear association, but again, we're looking for other potential causes of thyroid dysfunction. And then hormone imbalance, estrogen dominance. Let's break down the autoimmune thyroid patients. So 90% of autoimmune thyroiditis is due to Hashimoto's. And this is primarily anti-thyroperoxidase antibodies, but also anti-thyroglobulin. And more women than men develop autoimmune thyroid disease. And the most common onset is in puberty after pregnancy or menopause. But perhaps that's getting much broader now because of estrogen dominance, which is affecting women throughout life. And the most common symptoms, fatigue, one thing I think of, like a patient with fibromyalgia, with muscle aches and pains, you have to think that maybe they have subclinical hypothyroidism that is not completely apparent through the labs. Things like constipation, dry thinning hair, loss of the outer third of the eyebrow, doughy, puffy skin, even like puffy, rosy cheeks that I almost think of like Santa Claus. And here we are. So this is the picture of how thyroid hormone is synthesized. And you see out there is the outside, the blood vessel. And this is the thyroid follicular cell creating thyroglobulin inside the endoplasmic reticulum. And then it gets exocytosed, so it's moved out into the follicular colloid. And by then, it has all of these tyrosine residues attached along this long chain of thyroglobulin. And in comes thyroperoxidase, and it catalyzes the oxidation of iodide to iodine. And then that gets attached. So it also catalyzes the iodination of the tyrosyl residues, and then the conjugation to create the two hormones, thyroxine and triiodothyronine, which then gets released through a proteolysis into the circulation. To look at this a different way, we know that TSH stimulates the TSH receptor, which then activates the sodium iodide symporter. So it moves iodine from an area of lower concentration into an area of much higher concentration inside the thyroid tissue. And we know there's this NADPH oxidase system that produces hydrogen peroxide, which is then used by the thyroperoxidase enzyme, again, to produce iodine, which then gets attached to the thyroglobulin and then moved out again as T4, T3 out into the bloodstream. You notice that thyroperoxidase and thyroglobulin are proteins that are inside the thyroid cells. They are not proteins that should be exposed to our immune system. And yet patients with autoimmune thyroid disease have antibodies to these proteins. So again, it makes me think that what happens is the thyroid cells also break down. The same way that our guts become leaky, the thyroid becomes leaky and starts spilling some of these proteins out so they get exposed to our immune system and activate it. So is iodine friend or foe? What did you say? Well, when it comes to iodine, our thyroids have a Goldilocks complex. Too little is not good. Too much, probably not good either. So in Greece, they actually did a pretty good job of following the population. And back in the 1960s, there was iodine deficiency in the mountainous regions. And they found that there was a greater prevalence of goiter. But there wasn't really that much autoimmune thyroid disease. Now you move forward into the 80s and 90s, and what happened is what they called silent iodine prophylaxis. It's just because socioeconomic position improved, so people had more access to iodized salt, other iodine-rich foods. So what happened was that they saw a rise in autoimmune thyroiditis. So the iodine deficiency had been eliminated, but there seemed to be this emergence of autoimmune thyroid disease, and in particular, they saw that it was happening more. Hello? It was happening more in young women. To be or not to be? The question is to follow the TSH or not? This has been a source of huge debate for the last few decades. What is the normal TSH range? You know, now I've seen, you know, this is constantly changing. So I put 0.4 to 3.0, but some people believe it should be 2.5 as the upper limit. But if we went back a decade ago, the upper limit was around 8, then it was moved to the 7s, then it went down to 5.5 because we felt that we were missing too many thyroid patients, but maybe we just weren't looking more comprehensively and we had forgotten that the roots of medicine were about listening to the patient and not just looking at the blood test. So thyroid replacement therapy, these are the different types of hormones that can be used. And over the last 10 years of treating thyroid patients, I honestly can say that perhaps some of them are superior to others, but there is no perfect one that is good for every person. Thank you. You have the synthetics, the T4s. And when you give somebody this, you're depending on their own bodies to be able to convert this T4 to T3. Remember, that is the more active form of thyroid hormone. So if you have some sort of deficiency in the system that powers that 5' deiodinase, so if you have a trace mineral deficiency of zinc or selenium, you're not going to be able to convert this T4 to T3. So I get the patients that come to see me that are on Synthroid and they're not feeling any better and they're losing their hair. Then you have the synthetic T4, T3 combos. And then you have the synthetic solo T3s. You have Cytomel. And one that I actually use a lot with patients is slow-release T3. And I've had a lot of success with it. I don't really like Cytomel because of the short half-life, about 3 to 4 hours. So if a person is dosing Cytomel in the morning, they're not going to have the effects of that Cytomel by the time the afternoon comes. And then they have to time the dosing of the thyroid hormone after they've eaten. You can't take it for 2 hours after you've eaten or else you're not going to absorb it well. And a lot of people forget that afternoon dose. So I find it's much easier to give somebody a slow release T3 that's going to be released throughout the day if that's the way you're treating them. And then there are the biologicals, Armour, Natrethroid, Westroid, and these are porcine derived and they contain a mixture of both T4 and T3. And some of the other thyroid hormones. So some people just feel better on the biologicals, but not everyone. And that's been my experience over the 10 years, that some people actually still do better on a combination of T4 and T3 synthetic. And then again, because we're thinking about the gut and the connection to the thyroid, you have to consider that the thyroid patient maybe has protein malabsorption and you have to supplement with hydrochloric acid, betaine HCl, or maybe you have to supplement them with other enzymes. You have to work on their diet, gluten-free, dairy-free. Maybe they need a gluten digest enzyme for those times that they're eating out, and they might be exposed to gluten even though they don't think they were. And of course, then elemental trace minerals, bless you, and iodine and vitamins. We're gonna look at that in a little bit. Guys, you took away my animations. You took away my punchline here. So another thing to consider when you're treating a thyroid patient, so again, we see the connection between gluten, the damage it does, the tissue transglutaminase antibody. So then you have to think, am I giving the thyroid patient a medication that has gluten? So why would you give them a medication that has gluten when you're trying to get them to avoid gluten? Notice, do you notice which one is missing here in the list of gluten-free? Synthroid. So Synthroid is not guaranteed to be gluten-free. So my animation was going to have you guess which two of these thyroid medications have the least additives. Now there's a third arrow there, so it might throw you off still. So can you guess? So it's Tyrosint and Natrethroid. And now you're going to know the answer to my second question. Which one of these has a corn derivative? And I learned about this because I had a patient that came to see me that was taking Armour Thyroid and was not feeling well. And we researched it and saw that it actually had corn derivatives and he had a known corn allergy. So in this patient, he actually felt better when I switched him to Tyrosint and combined it with a slow-release T3. And then you have to think about common medications that might include gluten. I mean, just think of this, Advil migraine. We know the connection between gluten and migraines, and a migraine medication that's labeled such actually has gluten in it. And then here's another one, this is a great one, Amitiza, which is used for IBS with constipation. So how many IBS patients have gluten issues? And then migraine medication, birth control. Here's a great slide. This is probably one of my favorite slides from Dan Lukaser's lecture on the thyroid. It shows all the different minerals, vitamins that affect thyroid hormone production in every stage. So factors that make that contribute to proper thyroid hormone production are nutrients like iron, iodine, tyrosine, zinc, selenium, vitamins E, the B vitamins, C and D. And then you remember, it can either go to T3 or it can go to reverse T3. And the same factors that are going to inhibit the production of T3 are going to promote the production of reverse T3. So a lot of these are like stress, trauma, infection, fluoride. So how many of our thyroid patients are brushing their teeth with fluoride toothpaste? And another one that's not on here is chloride. Just think about all the water that we're exposed to in the shower and the baths that's chlorinated. Then toxins, pesticides. Mercury is a big one with the thyroid because it will also cause thyroid dysfunction without necessarily changing the thyroid numbers. So the patient will be tired, but maybe have a normal TSH. And autoimmune disease. So I talked about selenium and zinc. That helps the system that that converts T4 to T3. And then there's other nutrients that are involved with the sensitivity of the thyroid hormone receptor. So vitamin A, zinc, and a non-nutrient, exercise. So we come back to where we started. The gut, the adrenals, and the thyroid. And you see, you can't disconnect one system from the other. They're all interconnected. There may be multiple triggers. Patients are going to present with different things. So one patient may be more adrenal predominant. Another patient may have more thyroid issues. But they usually, all of them, have a gut issue. And you have to look at things like dysbiosis, infections, their use of medications, their exposure to food antigens like gluten and other food allergies or sensitivities, and how much stress is in their life and how that affects both the gut and the adrenals and the thyroid system. So we saw in my slides how this entire system is interconnected. And I wanted to come back to the picture of the tree. But this time, the tree, the body of the tree and the leaves, is represented by the Western medicine perspective, looking from the outside in. And the roots of the tree are represented by functional medicine instead of the gut, looking from the inside out. So functional medicine is looking for the root cause of disease, and that's what we want to spread throughout the world. Yes? The entire world? Yes?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thanks so much. Thanks so much, Dr. Pedre. It was awesome. And, you know, with a lot of, I hope everyone got a lot of learning lessons out of that one. I really feel like autoimmune disease is going to be the sort of the straw that breaks the camel's back, because the structures that are in place for autoimmune disease, which if you add up all the autoimmune diseases, is really the biggest issue facing and the biggest chronic disease. I think it's our trump card here in functional medicine. So thanks, Dr. Pedre, for talking about that. We've had quite a few questions on Twitter, and we'll have more, so keep them coming in. Shout out to the Kansas City meetup. I saw them. They're all a bit hungover, they're glad to be here and welcome. I didn't mention after the video of Cleveland Clinic, but the Cleveland Clinic is hiring. They want doctors to go and work at the Cleveland Clinic. They need doctors. That's why we played that video. So if you are interested, go to goevomed.com/recruit, and that'll take you to a page where they're taking applications. Very exciting time to be working there. So we did a survey of all of our practitioners last month to find out what were the biggest issues that were facing practitioners. practitioners. And we found that essentially the biggest issue is practitioners don't have enough time. And so as part of the, you know, the sponsors who sponsor the show, you know, we've really looked for technologies that help to increase the efficiency of functional medicine delivery. And all of the sponsors that we have actually do that perfectly. So I wanted to go through a couple of them here. So if you are familiar with functional medicine, you've got to be familiar with Living Matrix. Living Matrix is a technology that visualizes the functional medicine matrix. Now, up until now, doing the functional medicine matrix was a very time-intensive process, typically an hour to an hour and a half per patient. And I will tell you now that as long as that persists, it's going to be very hard to scale functional medicine for the masses, because any doctor or practitioner, an hour and a half times their hourly rate, we're putting up a quite a big barrier to the middle of the bell curve to come. So if you want to check out and do a demo, you go to goevomed.com/LM. They'll show you how essentially you can send out questions to patients ahead of time, and they answer those questions before they ever come into your practice, and it populates into the functional medicine matrix automatically. I think this is going to be a big step, and more than anything, it's going to track the outcomes of all of the clinics using the same system, which I think is going to be really important for functional medicine. So goevomed.com/LM if you're interested in checking out more about that. Another great sponsor that we have is BodySite. You know, a lot of practitioners are using health coaches or other practitioners to help implement the changes that they talk about. And we definitely feel here at the Forum that it's a combination of functional medicine, coaching, and technology that's really going to scale functional medicine and make it the new standard of care. So BodySite is a tool that you can use. Think about it for your patients. You know, if you ask them to make diet changes, diet changes is a difficult thing to do, because you're not just taking supplements, doing one thing. You have to change your shopping list, and you have to go out and buy the different foods, and you have to learn to cook the different foods. What BodySite does is, if you put someone on a gluten-free diet, say, they'll give you shopping lists, recipes, and all those kind of things, and it completely scales. You can do it for as many patients as possible. So go and check out goevomed.com/BodySite. Great time-saving tool, particularly if you have a small practice. We've spoken about telemedicine before. I know a practitioner in San Francisco who told me recently they've scaled back from 5 days a week in their practice to 1 day a week in their practice and 4 days a week on telemedicine. And they've cut their overhead by 4/5. Because they don't need to actually be in an office anytime soon. So I think this is a real potential. You know, what we're seeing right now is that there's way more demand for functional medicine than supply. The demand is going up. It's only going to go up even more when Dr. Chatterjee's show comes out and all the books that are coming out. And so being able to do telemedicine, if you have an integrated micro practice, really gives you a lot more scale and to be able to give a lot more patients access to your clinic. So go to goevomed.com/Chiron and you can take a demo with them. Definitely a best in category telemedicine resource. I mentioned this company last time. We've got a podcast about them coming out on Thursday. This is Uber for phlebotomists. I know it sounds a bit wacky, but you know, imagine, you know, your patients, this is what I said last time, 50% of your patients, when you recommend getting one of these tests, they don't go. They don't go. 50% of tests that are recommended by doctors don't get done because they have to go to a third-party site to go and get it done. It's hard. So use a little Iggy. You go and you sign up, and you can actually have a driver, and you can watch them in their sort of like Uber-like thing pull up to the patient's house, to the patient's office. They can come into your house. Phlebotomy is changing quickly, and Igbo is on the cutting edge, saving you a lot of time too. We spoke about HealthWave. They are now offering a 40% margin to practitioners who use their in-house platform. They have, Dr. Pedres actually works with them a lot, and all of the top practitioners that we work with who are looking for a great user experience for their online are using HealthWave. So you can go to goevomed.com/HealthWave. Try it on a few patients. I think you'll see a serious shift in their adherence to your protocols and so forth. And then our last sponsor is Freedom Practice Coaching. If you are a doctor who is interested in building a successful integrated medicine practice or functional medicine practice, and you don't have time to get it wrong, you know, I think that functional FPC is really helping practitioners to get the right business model in order to make it work. So we all have very limited amount of time. I appreciate all of you guys making time to be here, and we're really excited that our technology sponsors are helping practices to become way more efficient, and that's exactly what we're looking to do here at the Functional Forum. Just another reminder that we will there'll be some IFM Presents segments at the annual conference for Integrative Healthcare Symposium, February 24th to 27th. Some favorites, Dr. Hyman, Dr. Perlmutter. There's quite a lot of functional medicine people there. Christy Hughes. So we're gonna be doing some cool stuff at that, and you'll find out more about that soon. Again, good time to ask questions on Twitter. Now, I've spoken a lot about how we think that technology can scale functional medicine and make it available to the masses, but that's quite an, you know, is that a concept that everyone can understand what that means? Maybe not. So I want to give an example of what that looks like. And I said today earlier that we think it's functional medicine is the operating system of the future of chronic disease management, but it's coaching that's really going to change behavior. And we've seen on this show, we've had all the top functional medicine doctors to come and speak, a lot of them. But if you were looking to the coaching world, who is really making the biggest impact? And I wanted to introduce my friend Elisa Vitti. If nothing else, she is helping patients in 216 countries, right? So 216 countries, women are interacting with her platform. That's impact. You know, that's really exciting work. And I say more than anything, Elisa, I really appreciate the fact that you walk the talk and have had a baby and come back stronger and better than ever. So to talk about how to use food and to with the Hormone Symphony, it's Elisa Vitti.
You know, now I'm regretting picking that song. Okay. Hi, I'm Elisa Vitti. I'm a coach and an integrative nutritionist, and I am a passionate ambassador of periods and hormones and getting women to interact with their hormonal conversation, becoming less more sensitized to the changes that their body is sharing with them, and learning how to, you know, navigate that with diet and lifestyle. And I get around as much as I can. I made a little TV history on Dr. Oz and showed simulated menstruation. It was the most controversial segment that ever got pitched to them, and they were, half of the producers were like, I'm not, we can't. And the other half were like, well, we talked about poop, so we have to talk about periods. I mean, I can't believe they're in the same category, but whatever. So anyway, I got to go and talk about the different colors and what to look at before you flush to help you understand what might be happening with the relationship between estrogen and progesterone every month, and how you can, as an individual woman, start to navigate that conversation and not wait until you have bigger and bigger issues. And I write for a bunch of publications. I'm really proud to be on the Health Advisory Board for Yahoo Health. I pen their Hormone Whisperer column. I talk about hormones and periods and everything as much as humanly possible. I do ovaries all day long. I love it. My book, Woman Code, I wrote it 3 years ago. Dr. Northrup graced me with a beautiful introduction, and it has been ranked in the top 50 of women's health books of all times, and I'm really proud that women are reading it and taking charge of their health each and every day. What I built, so I had a practice in the city for 10 years, and then 4 years ago, I was just overwhelmed. I had women from different time zones and geographic regions reaching out to me saying, can you work with me, can you work with me? And I was running out of bandwidth and days, hours in the day to reach all of them. So I raised a small angel round and built the world's first immersive client hormone interface. And so women can log into our system, go through our online program, learn basic endocrinology for the layperson, and how to engage their system with food. Food as the primary therapy, because what we see is that if it just stays sort of in this supplements only or synthetic hormones or even bioidentical hormones only conversation, that the patient tends to slide back into bad lifestyle and dietary choices that exacerbate their hormonal condition. So we really need to get the patients excited about what food can do for them. And what's great about food as a primary therapy for hormonal imbalances is that the results are so profound and immediate that once you start feeling better, you keep doing it. You keep eating the foods that make you feel better. What's really also great is that we've been so well embraced by the medical community. So we're really fortunate to be able to partner with some of the top IVF centers in the nation, as well as functional medicine practitioners and their centers, to help leverage what we've put together for their patients. So that, because what we're doing is really rolling up our sleeves and getting into the nitty-gritty of food coaching. What do you do in between sessions, after all the thyroid testing, after all the IgG testing, after all the testing? What does it mean for you as the patient in the kitchen when you're ordering food at a restaurant, when you're traveling, when you're living your life? How do you actually take this into your life? And this is what the hormonal sync system does for a woman. It really trains her on how to navigate all of that. And we have a really exciting forum where other health coaches can answer questions 24/7, and we have rich discussion from women in different parts of the world offering their stories, sharing their experiences of not only living in hormonal chaos, but what it means to them to get back into hormonal flow by having food be their main support system. You know, here's what I've seen in 15 years of practice. This is a growing problem that's not gotten any better. In fact, it's getting worse. 20 million, and that's, I think, a conservative number, and this is just U.S. information, are suffering with menstrual fertility and low libido issues. So these are women 25 to 45 struggling with this situation. The fertility issue is so enormous. I mean, it's more and more younger couples who are finding themselves in a position where they cannot do what is biologically natural for them to be doing without medical intervention. And even with the medical intervention, it is not working. So there's deeper issues going on. This statistic blew my mind. Did you know that $2 billion is lost in corporate America due to women taking sick days for cramps? Just cramps. We didn't talk about fibroids and PMDD and endometriosis. Just cramps. Okay. Okay. Then the birth control pill conversation. If you don't know, I'm really proud to say that Ricky Lake and Abby Epstein are producing a new documentary called Sweetening the Pill, which I've recently been interviewed for. And we're going to be looking at this whole conversation. Is the pill the best ubiquitous treatment for hormonal conditions like polycystic ovarian syndrome, which I had, by the way? I used to be over 200 pounds, covered in cystic acne, not menstruating for a decade, and a student at Johns Hopkins wanting to become an OBGYN when all of this hormonal crisis hit for me. Was told I'd never get pregnant, got pregnant on the third try at advanced maternal age, have a baby, da-da-da-da-da. Okay. You know, there's ways to get through, but you have to be committed to the food piece. But this conversation about birth control pills is really concerning to me because it's a mask for the symptoms. You know, you're shutting down the hypothalamic pituitary ovarian conversation with these medications, and the body kind of goes into this, dormancy around these symptoms, and then a woman wants to go off of them to get pregnant, or she decides, I'm just tired of taking medications. We have this growing population of young women who are, reading all of these amazing sites like Mind Body Green, Yahoo Health, and they're doing yoga, they're meditating, they're drinking juice, and they're like, this is out of integrity with my personal values that I'm on this kind of medication. So they go off, or they're afraid to go off because they know their symptoms are going to come back and bite them. And so we have a whole birth control rehab program that we do for women to help them go off without having the acne and the bloating and the mood swings come back, so that they feel confident to wean off that medication, of course, with their physician's monitoring. But I also think the bigger issue is that we have not studied what the long-term effects of placing teenage girls at 12 and 13 and 15 on birth control pills and letting them remain on that pill for 10 to 15 to 20 years on their fertility, on all sorts of things. And I'm not a betting woman, but if I were, I would say that if we did do a study about it, that there would be a lot of research that would show that this is not the best way to go. And in fact, women in our generation, if you have children, if you have daughters, or if you're in a position to influence mothers in your practice and their teen daughters, please have a conversation with them about other choices, that food is the best way that they could start navigating their daughter's excess estrogen, as opposed to just putting them on the pill. But of course, that's a conversation that needs to be had earlier and earlier, because by the time the kid's a teenager, she doesn't want to listen to you anyway. This, you know, Dr. Vincent Pedre talked a lot about endocrine disruptors, so I'm not going to go into it too much, but, and you did an amazing job talking about it. I would say that, you know, the issue for women these days is that our exposure is so vastly, there's a statement that I read earlier that we, our generation is exposed to more chemicals in a 30-day period than our grandparents' generation was exposed to their entire lifetime. My grandmother lived till she was 95 in perfect health. I developed an amazing conflagration of the worst of the PCOS symptomology by the time I was 18, one, two generations out. So it's, you know, overexposure to the wheat products, sugar, chemicals in cleaning products at home, in your skincare, caffeine and sugar dependence, of course, medication, but also, and one of them got cut off, sorry, extreme dieting and exercise trends. You know, there's so many women so desperate to change the way their body looks that they will do crazy things with food, like cut out all sort of food groups except for one in a desire to control their body, and they'll over-exercise. And so this creates a perfect storm of micronutrient deficiency, which of course makes them more vulnerable for hormonal problems. And then what got cut off was sort of this sleep crisis and stress crisis that we're all in. I just sleep trained my daughter. Anybody has ever done that? Oh my God, I can't believe I waited so long. So she's one, and I was, you know, just nursing her all night long, and I thought that was probably in her best interest. But no, in fact, I watched during the sleep training process her go into her natural cortisol down regulation cycles and fall asleep, no problem. And I thought, this is even more important for adults to not lose track of the fact that we do all operate in all of our organs within the endocrine system on circadian patterns, and we need to adhere to them 80% of the time, because 20% of the time you got to go party. But 80% of the time you can do it, because you know you're not out partying all the time. One thing I love talking about, I wish I could make t-shirts, I want you to talk about it more, is that in 10 years ago, the National Institute of Health came out with a really important study called the BioCycle Study, which linked PMS, you know that thing we joke about, like, oh, don't talk to me right now, I'm in that time of the month. If untreated for a decade or more, can increase the likelihood of the diseases of inflammation, the big four: diabetes, heart disease, cancer, dementia. I don't think that's funny. And I think if more women knew that their PMS was going to set them up for a postmenopausal aging situation where they would be more vulnerable to this kind of inflammation, I think they would make very different choices in their 20s and their 30s. I think they would think about, gee, let me get off the pill. Let me start to address the root causes of my symptoms and really get on top of this. I think they would. We get extraordinary results for women because we really work with them in their everyday lives. We really roll up our sleeves and we really help them navigate how this works with food. So Emily is a great example. She had two periods a month, so she was presenting with subclinical thyroid issues, and we did not necessarily treat her for her thyroid issues. We obviously refer out to plenty of practitioners who, again, we have such a great relationship with functional doctors, because they like to send people for us for the food, and we like to send people to them for tests and all of the medications that they need. But when it came to her results, she was able to regulate her cycle, get off of birth control, get off of the naproxen, and of course get her life back so she could go and do the acting, you know, stuff that she was doing. Lisa was our fertility, sort of a great catch example of our fertility clients. She had was going into her second pregnancy. Her first pregnancy had, because she had PCOS, multiple failed rounds of IVF, finally got pregnant, but all of the synthetic hormone stimulation she received set her up to have, you know, postpartum depression after that first pregnancy, and her son was showing some ADHD, and so she really wanted to do everything she could to make the second pregnancy a completely different story. So she came to us, prepped her body for 6 months, boosted her micronutrient levels, ate according to the four phases that we talk about. And she was able to, on the second try, get pregnant without IVF, carry a very healthy pregnancy, second child, very different cognitively and behaviorally from the first child. And she, of course, did not have postpartum depression at all. So a great example of what just food can do for a woman to really put her in the driver's seat of her body. And Fran is someone who is in our perimenopausal conversation. She was dealing with low libido, vaginal dryness, was on vaginal suppositories and other HRT, and it wasn't doing anything for her. And she was as fit as you could hope to be at 48. She was a professional amateur, I don't know what you call it, pro-am ballroom dancer, amazing body. And to look at her, you would think everything was hot, and it was not. And so again, getting her to change her diet to really look at, and we're gonna go through the steps of how the protocol works in a moment. 3 months is our average turnaround time for symptoms to no symptoms. And of course, women lose weight and their moods get better and their cycles get regulated and their blood sugar issues go away as well. It's pretty good. Okay, how does it work? Pretty straightforward. The protocol has four key parts. The first part is what I call the cleanup phase, which is where we really help the patient understand some of the key drivers of endocrine function, right? One of the big ones being blood sugar regulation. If that doesn't go well, the endocrine system isn't happy and not much else will go well in terms of hormonal balance. And then, of course, we talk about nourishing the adrenals and flushing cortisol because, again, we have this stress crisis and the sleep crisis and magnesium deficiency and all sorts of deficiencies that make our cortisol issues as bad as they are. And then in the third step of this first piece of the protocol, we improve the elimination. So yes, here we talk about poop a lot. Improve elimination and support the microbiome. So really, again, some of the great conversations you were talking about really getting them conscious of just how bad their microbiome or dysbiosis might be, sending them to a specialist if need be, but really doing some of the key basics. I mean, you'd be amazed with the majority of people coming to us with these issues just are missing some of the key basics of supporting their microbiome. They're eating no prebiotics, they're not taking any fermented foods, and they're not doing anything that's helping their microbiome. So some of the, just adding those in, just remarkable things for them. And then in the second piece of our protocol, this is sort of the maintenance piece. So I wrote about this in my book. There's a couple of really great easy charts that you can refer to in chapter 5 of Woman Code. But this is what we call the cycle syncing diet. So I'm going to break that down for you in a moment. But essentially, we have women eat, exercise, and organize their lifestyle around the four distinct patterns of hormones that they have each phase of the cycle. And what this provides for them, of course, is a framework for operating within their unique female system with the world and food and exercise, and gives them a routine that they can rely on so that they don't find themselves off track in any other way. Here are some examples of some of the specific foods that we really push hard on for the first half of the protocol, the cleanup phase. So for example, if we're working on someone's blood sugar stability, oftentimes it's just such a hard conversation just to get your patients to eat carbohydrates, because women are terrified of carbohydrates and fat and anything that is food related. So, you know, sweet potatoes and avocados are a great example of things that help stabilize the blood sugar. But, you know, you'd be amazed at how many women are like, well, I'm just going to have some black tea and a fruit and, you know, a trail, like a Larabar. And that makes them feel like they're in control because it's in a package they can open and it's one thing. But really, they're not doing themselves any hormonal favors with that kind of dietary mentality. Dealing with cortisol, you know, we really look to do as much as we can to improve vitamin C levels, vitamin B5 levels, and so I love chickpeas and any kind of organic berry. Of course, organic food is a prerequisite for all of this. Detoxification. For me, this is really how can we restore enough levels of micronutrients that the liver needs in-house to go through its phases of detoxification, because so many women are deficient. They're drinking so much coffee. They're under so much stress. Their bodies are, and they're dieting, over-exercising. They're so depleted in the minerals and vitamins that their livers need to actually do the estrogen metabolic job, that we just need to kind of boost those things. So Brazil nuts are great for selenium, you know, eggs, wonderful, can't say enough about eggs. Okay, thyroid. Again, we're talking about some basic support to help women navigate this from a very, you know, lifestyle maintenance piece. So sea vegetables are great. Artichokes are great. Artichokes actually help the conversion of T4 to T3. So it's a really great thing to do if that's an issue for women. Just have them eat more of that less raw broccoli, less raw spinach, less raw kale, which is another issue when you're overjuicing all the time. You may inadvertently damage thyroid function that way. Microbiome, prebiotics in the form of sunchokes or Jerusalem artichokes, and sauerkraut, fermented sauerkraut, can't go wrong with that. Okay, then we move into this maintenance piece. So here are the four phases of the cycle. I know you all know that, but I can't tell you how many times I teach, and I'm like, okay, so what are the phases of the cycle? And people are like, ovulation and menstruation, and there's like a just a blind spot for this conversation because women are not getting this information, unfortunately, in a ubiquitous enough way that they know where they are in their own cycle. So part of this is sort of the upregulation of this information. So we teach them, you know, how do you know where you are in your cycle if you're not on the pill? How can you tell emotionally, physically? What are some of the cues to look out for? I mean, this is really like just basic navigation through the body. But beyond that, we get them to, and this was another part of the fun segment I did on Dr. Oz, we get them to eat specific foods that really do a couple of things. One, improve estrogen metabolism throughout the four phases of the cycle, especially where estrogen is peaking, which is primarily the ovulatory phase and the luteal phase in different levels. And some of this is based on traditional Chinese medicine, but kind of with my, you know, functional nutrition understanding. And so, but the other thing that it does is it also helps promote progesterone production as well, which is another issue that we see why younger and younger women are dealing with so many of these issues with fertility and low libido and things that you would normally not have seen in your practice until she was 45 or older. We're now seeing women at 25 presenting with, has a lot to do with this estrogen elevation and low levels of progesterone production. So eating in this way actually really helps a woman get a broad spectrum of the foods that help with all of the aspects of the endocrine function, as well as estrogen metabolism, as well as progesterone production, and allows her to, again, have anchors in where she's at in the cycle. And energetically, too, you know, we talk about energy medicine. You know, the first half of the cycle is a lighter, more energized time of a woman's month, right? She has more testosterone in the ovulatory phase. She has lower levels of estrogen in the follicular phase. So she's feeling more buoyant. And so it makes sense that you would do better on lighter foods, raw foods, the first half of the cycle. Your body's more able to assimilate nutrients that way. Second half of the cycle, there's a tremendous amount of effort being put into progesterone production in the luteal phase. And you start to have a decline in testosterone. So that boot camp class you went to, you know, in your ovulatory phase, which you sailed out of on cloud nine, in the second half of the luteal phase, you're praying to God is ending anytime in the next 5 minutes. And that's an important conversation to have beyond the food, because we women think we should be performing at the same level every single day. But our bodies are cyclical in nature, and we need a lifestyle and a diet that honors what's physiologically happening to us. It's not like we're just, this is a nice idea. This is actually what's going on. And so it would be really great if more and more women could really start to align with that rhythm, because it reduces friction in the body's overall performance, especially around adrenal health. I see this over and over again, that a missing link for adrenal health in women is cycle syncing their exercise schedule, really making sure that they're doing that high-intensity workout in the first half and more yoga, Pilates, walking in the second half. Not because they can't do it, but because we're talking about reducing stress on the adrenals while they're healing from PCOS, fibroids, infertility, etc. Okay. Right. All right. Some superfood strategies in case you're coming across patients who need some extra support. I can't stress cooked dark leafy greens enough for period problems. The magnesium in these vegetables does wonders, but also sweet root vegetables. Carrots and sweet potatoes and squash I mean, it's the fall, and that pumpkin chai latte girl joke is going around. So, you know, find a way. We do great recipes on the blog around, you know, smoothies and things that incorporate these foods. But really getting that vitamin A in so that the liver can metabolize estrogen is so important. Again, we try to work with women where they're at. So if they like juices and they're going to get that on a regular basis, do something that's going to support, you know, your cycle, especially, you know, leading up to the luteal phase. Something like cilantro especially has great liver detoxifying effects. Reducing, I would say, is a gentle, what I really mean is eliminating soy products. But, you know, I have to be sort of politically correct. And what if your patient is vegan? No problem. There are so many great vegan sources of protein that are not soy-based that you really want to encourage them to stay away from soy. If they're estrogen dominant, you know, yes, a little bit of fermented soy will help, but that's not what people are eating. Who do you know goes out of their way to eat natto? I do, but you know they don't, right? So, you know, a little bit of fermented miso, a little bit of soy sauce is okay, but really the problem is that people are doing tofu, they're doing soy milk, they're doing soy ice cream, soy yogurt, and it's too much on their system, and it's adding to the estrogen overload in their system. And then, of course, getting them to change their products, which is, you know, that's a whole beauty conversation. But, you know, I love makeup, and I use all green, organic, non-endocrine disruptive makeup. And nail polish, 7-free, not 5-free. 5-free is not good enough. You know, you have to go and really do your work. But I think women are excited to try these new things as long as they make them look good. Fertility superfood strategies. You know, the studies are in that food affects fertility. So if someone is coming to you with fertility challenges, you really want to be talking to them about what are you eating on a day-to-day basis. Avocado, 3 avocados a week has been shown to increase the success rates of IVF by 3.5 times. So if your patient is dealing with not getting pregnant and they're not eating avocados every day, twice a day, you might want to encourage that. turmeric, for women who have things like congestion in the uterus, what does that mean? Heavy clotting, periods, fibroids, dark menstruation. Turmeric is great. It's a drying, warming herb that can really help dispel that dampness in the uterus and really help promote a healthier flow, which is good for implantation. Cinnamon helps restore ovulatory cycles. Buckwheat for my PCOS girls, rich in dechironocetol, also helps with ovulation regulation. Eggs, royal jelly, these are just some of the basics. Sex drive. Again, this is now for every decade, but it's an adrenal conversation, so B5, all the Bs. Women are so deficient in B vitamins. Get all your patients on a B100 complex. I'm sure you're doing that. Do it. Caffeine. I go around and say these very unpopular things. Michelle knows. Don't drink coffee. it's so hard. It's the national drug of choice. I think it's a gateway drug. I really do. Although you could argue caffeine and sugar, they're both gateway drugs to a life of, you know, eventual disease state in the body. So it's just not worth it, especially for women. Yes, there are some studies that say that caffeine can be beneficial, but those studies are mainly for men. And for women, this is just more problematic for our endocrine regulation. So I stay away from it, especially when it comes to sex drive. And then the exercising according to your cycle is so critical because, again, you're reducing that stress on the adrenals, and that makes a huge, huge impact. All right, last slide is just some super plants that I love for regulating some of the functionality of the endocrine system. Berberine, cinnamon for insulin, ashwagandha and holy basil for cortisol, milk thistle and cilantro for the liver, and vitex and evening primrose oil for the pituitary gland, which, you know, of course, if you're dealing with any hormonal issue, you have to look and see what the pituitary function is doing. So, you know, I'm so happy to talk to any of you who are dealing with patients who suffer from hormonal issues and find ways that we can support your practice with our food training program for your patients. But also, I would just encourage you as physicians to test, do more tests. People, the women are so desperate to just be validated that they're bouncing around from practitioner to practitioner. In fact, there's a statistic that has been out that health insurance companies lose about $5,000 per woman per year because she is moving from different doctor to try to find out why she doesn't feel right. and she can't put her finger on it because we don't really have the vocabulary about our own physical experiences. And so, you know, keep doing tests. But then the other side of that is to just change the expectation with these women. Change that conversation that there is everything that they could be doing between visits with you with food. That every meal, every day practice is just as important as their yoga practice, their meditation practice. This is what will regulate their hormones overall and make them feel great all month long, which is, by design, how we should feel. I'm Alisa. I love hormones. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much, Alisa. We are running a few minutes late here, but we are going to have a panel because we've had a few questions. So if we can bring out the chairs, and we've got Alisa and Vince are going to jump up here. We also have Elizabeth Gregg, who's a nurse practitioner working at Dr. Susan Bloom Center in Westchester. And we have Dr. Nancy Cotter. So if you guys want to jump up here, we have had a few questions from Twitter, and I'm sure we have a few here in the audience. Before we go, so Dr. Cotter, let's get a mic if you want to grab your mics here, first of all. Dr. Cotter, you've been doing this a while here, functional medicine. Just make sure your mic is on there. How do you feel that your strategies are similar or different to what Dr. Pedre shared here in his talk?
Well, I think the nice thing about functional medicine is that it gives us a way to look at the complex patient, and it gives us a language to have the conversation. And so when I understood and agree with everything that Dr. Pedre had to say, and he didn't pay me to say that. but that is our approach. And these are not just beliefs, they're tried and true. I mean, the reason that I'm doing functional medicine is because it helped a family member of mine, my own mother, who was really circling the drain, as we say. But that was 13 years ago, and she recently blew out the candles on her 96th birthday cake because of functional medicine. So it's a framework to look at things, look at the complex patient, and a way to very reasonably navigate through a complex situation.
So. Now, Doc, I know you have a private practice, but you also work inside the VA system.
Yes.
How are those two different, and how can we expect change coming into the VA? Because I know Tracy is really trying to make a big change there.
Yes, absolutely. One of the things, one of the notions that I like to dispel about functional medicine is many people think, and I know I'm probably speaking to the choir, but many people think that functional medicine surrounds, is all about the right supplements and the right testing, and it really isn't. It's really about the values that we talked about tonight. And so despite the fact that it is difficult to do some of these sort of boutique interventions in the VA, we have a population that is greatly in need of and very hungry for the approach that functional medicine takes. And so, I mean, I have patients asking for it by name. I don't have an appointment available till I think February or March. And so it is being very much embraced by the patients, and I'm surprised that they come asking for it.
That's great. Yeah, I appreciate you sharing that, and we look forward to progress in that area because there's a lot of people that need it. And Escape Fire actually does a great job of showing how they're working with veterans differently.
Yeah, we're actually going to show that next week.
Awesome. Yeah, that's really exciting. Elizabeth, you work as a nurse practitioner in Dr. Bloom's center. What is your sort of role on the team, and how can we get more nurse practitioners into the functional movement?
In our practice, we have several physicians, myself and a nutritionist, and actually each one of us sees patients independently, and then we also refer to each other within the practice. Everyone who comes in sees a clinician, and everyone sees a nutritionist. Mary Goki is our fabulous nutritionist, and she sees people independently, but she also sees every single person who comes in, because we feel like food is the primary method of treatment, as Alisa pointed out. If you can't fix your food, you can't really fix your health. So that's number one. And then Dr. Blum, Dr. McConnell, Dr. Yee, and myself all see people with a wide variety of health conditions. Mostly we see people with autoimmune conditions, because Susan wrote a book about the immune system recovery program, and so that's kind of the reputation that we have. But I think people, as Dr. Cotter was saying, are hungry for functional medicine. So when people walk into my office and I say, how do you hear about us? They often Googled and they found us. And I have people coming to me all the time asking me if I would come and please join their practice as a nurse practitioner. So I know there are lots of opportunities for nurse practitioners. I had someone call me just recently and say, you know, would you come and work for me? Because nurse practitioners, I don't think know as much about functional medicine, but I think as I go to the functional medicine conferences year after year, more and more nurse practitioners are there. They're starting their own practices. We just had somebody call us today, a nurse practitioner who wanted to come to us for a mentoring program, and that's something that we're beginning to start doing so that people can get their education, but then they need a practical place to practice.
So you're seeing a lot of immune patients. Would you agree with what I said, that the autoimmune disease will sort of be the disease category that may help functional medicine hit the mainstream?
I think so, because so many people who come to us who've seen their rheumatologist, the only choice they're really given is a medication, and they want more. You know, they really want to know, how can I reverse this? How can I turn it around? What can I do that will really make me feel healthy instead of just getting by on meds and trying to stop the progression or slow the progression of my disease? And what we find in functional medicine, which I'm sure everybody on this panel has found, is that not only can you slow the progression, you can reverse the progression. You can get people off their meds. They can feel good because we get at the root cause for really what's going on with them.
That's awesome. Elisa, I wanted to just ask you about your diet, because it has a dynamic component. You know, it changes over the month. And we had Dr. Nicholas Gonzalez here in January talking about his protocol. I think Dr. Isaacs is somewhere in the room here too. You know, he had an idea of balancing the autonomic nervous system with food, and it was dynamic. You know, different people would need different things depending on theirs. And, you know, we have so much dogma about what's the best diet. And I just wonder how scalable you feel a diet, you know, the best diet is, when the best diet isn't the same thing all the time.
Well, So, you know, I think what I'm finding is that women will start to engage this dynamic diet. That's a lovely way of putting it. And they'll see how easy it actually is, because what's predictable is that they're cycle is going to go through their cycle, right? They're going to have these four distinct hormonal phases. That is going to happen with predictability. And so they can start to plan around that. And it's not that complicated, because it isn't about excluding other foods that aren't, you know, phase specific in that week. It's really about prioritizing some of the foods that really do help in each week. And what we also see is that it has this sort of viral component to it. So, for example, we have, we get letters all the time, email letters from women who, one of them reads the book or does the program online, they start cycle syncing and they tell their coworkers about it, and then their whole team is doing it. And so women share this with each other as a way of living in their bodies that really is easier than they thought when they first heard about it. So I think it's just about engaging it and really seeing it firsthand, that it's not so complicated.
Awesome. We are running a couple minutes late, but let me just give an opportunity for anyone in the audience to ask a question to the panel. Anyone want to have a go here? We've got some brilliant minds. Vince, we've had a question here just about your talk. Someone asked on Twitter with regard to detoxification in the process, how you, in what order you sort of would do detoxification and when you're trying to balance hormones.
I think I'm doing that from the beginning. So it's, the way I look at the body is, it's basically a symphony. And you have a whole bunch of different instruments playing, and you can look at the hormone system that way, the gut. And if the violins are out of sync and the tuba is playing the wrong note and the violas are flat when they should be sharp, then the entire system is knocked out of balance. So the way I approach the patient is to address everything together, but usually starting with the gut and detoxing through proper diet changes, and getting them to change lifestyle habits, whether nutrition, or, you know, the other thing I didn't talk about, you know, in relation to the adrenals, is the toxicity of our minds, you know, all the negative thoughts that plague us. And I talk to my patients sometimes about that, about changing your thoughts, about creating positive affirmations and bringing gratitude in. So we have to think about not only detoxifying ourselves from our environment and from the chemicals by changing our habits, like not using plastic, not heating something in a microwave in plastic, or like Elisa was talking about, the things we apply to our faces, the makeup. But also, you have to, I think, address the spiritual toxicity that plagues us. And to me, I don't know, it's, I look at everything simultaneously, so I can't say that I separate one thing over another unless a patient has some sort of infection that needs to be treated. And that's the primary source of inflammation, so then you want to treat that first. You know, say they have Lyme disease. Yeah. But I hope that answers your question.
That's a good question. And maybe just a quick question for all of you here. I mean, that was quite complicated, some of what Dr. Pedre put up on the board, all the numbers and letters and so forth. How do you make this process easy for patients to really understand so they can participate? Because the beauty of the functional medicine paradigm is they have to participate. I'd imagine you have to make it easy for them to understand the process. Are there stories or structures or things that you use in order to help patients understand this symphony? Yeah.
You know, you mentioned stories, and oftentimes what patients respond to is a story about somebody just like them. And what I do with the vets actually is they love to talk to each other, very willing to talk to each other. And so I'll ask one person if I, you know, could connect them with another. And we don't, they don't really need, many patients don't really need a lot of physiology. Some of them want it, and you can simplify the process for them. But oftentimes, a very meaningful story is something that speaks to them, and they say, "Oh, there's hope for me too." You know, so
that's great.
Yeah,
Elizabeth.
I think it's also getting people to tell their story. You know, that's such a big part of healing, is to understand where they've come from and what were all the factors that brought them to where they are today, and then what factor is really most important for them to kind of emphasize in their life now, and to help them find that healing path. And then once you kind of know what their priority is and what they really want to make a change in, then I can start to give them some guidance on that. So it's kind of getting their story and taking the lead from them and then working through step by step.
That's great, because it's so participatory. It's got to involve them. It's got to be doing that. Dr. Carter, one more.
Yes, I just wanted to bounce off what Mary just said, and that is that we do something in functional medicine called the timeline, where we ask them in detail about what happened really from birth to, you know, to today. And when they see how their physiologic changes happen in proximity to emotional changes, life changes, I mean, that's a way of, you know, when we tell their story back to them, they get these incredible aha moments, and they're more, I don't want to say willing, but they see in wonderful detail and great relief, really how related their whole web is, their whole life, as Dr. Pedre said, about, you know, their emotional life and their physiological life. So yeah,
I'm just going to jump in quickly and say that I think, and it could be just the very specialized niche that I focus on, but women are starving for the information about how their bodies actually work. You have to remember that the last time a woman was taught what was going on in her body was typically 6th, 7th grade, and it was like, you get a period, and here are the tampons, and don't have unprotected sex. And she has a huge blind spot about what is happening in her body, this, and that the fact that she then feels like her body is failing her because she's having fertility issues, or she's having you know, she's a different person one half of the month to the other because her cramps are so bad, or etc. She feels like this body that she has is betraying her, is mysterious, is unpredictable, is bad. So I find that giving them very approachable, you know, explanation about their endocrine system, you know, and again, from a layman's perspective, and again, just basic cycle education is so empowering. They love knowing about it, and then it's just ingrained in them that they have this cyclicality, they want to eat for that, and it makes the whole process of adhering to the protocol a no-brainer for them, because they know why they're doing it. You know, I always say I don't eat broccoli because it's good for me. I eat it when it's good for my cycle, and women love that. Like, oh, I'm doing this for me, for my unique female self, which needs a lot of special TLC.
Vince?
I'm going to add, I don't know if you can tell, but I'm very visual and I love pictures. So I will use a picture with a patient Like earlier today, I had a patient that has gluten sensitivity and also tested positive for one of the HLA markers for celiac disease. And I had seen her daughter, and she had also tested positive for the HLA marker. So I was showing her what type of damage gluten can do to her gut lining just by showing her the simple diagrams of what a gut lining looks like that's healthy versus a leaky gut. And that really helped drive the point in about what's going on in her body. And then the other thing I will add is that I agree with everything that everyone said. The other thing I do is kind of learn where the patient is and negotiate with them, because you may have this beautiful grand plan to fix their body symphony, but they're not ready to start with everything that you have. So maybe they're just willing to try eliminating dairy from their diet right now. Or maybe they're just willing to try gluten, but they're not going to do anything else. So you have to kind of see where they're at and meet them halfway, and then just kind of keep, you're the navigator and you're pushing them to get to where you know they need to go.
Absolutely. Well, look, I just want to bring the whole thing together here because we've come to an end of the event. You know, our goal here at the Functional Forum is to catalyze more and more doctors to get involved with endocrine, with functional medicine. And one of the groups that we think would be an obvious choice to do it is endocrinologists. And that's why we started with Mike Mutzel at the beginning, because the Endocrine Society is telling people that these endocrine disruptors are causing big problems, and the regular physician doesn't really have any tools to be able to deal with that. Functional medicine does have those tools. So for those people who at the, what we feel like what we wanted to do at this talk is to provide an opportunity for functional medicine meetup hosts, our functional forum meetups, to invite endocrinologists to this. This talk, this hour and a half that we've had, will be available for free on the internet forever. Ask an endocrinologist if the functional forum might be right for them, because we need to get more and more doctors doing it, and I think endocrinology is a perfect example. So in that vein, our next functional forum is December the 7th. It's called From Retox to Detox. It's also the Christmas party, and we're going to be talking about detox, so that's why it is. But I would just say to everyone that the reason why we're doing it is because we want to set it up in December so that all of you and other practices can set up your detox programs for January. This has been the Functional Forum. Thanks so much to all of our guests. It's been great, and we'll see you next time.